the first day. The evening and the morning constituted the second day. The evening and the morning, as you read down in Genesis, the first chapter of Genesis is a record that you can always refer to, which tells you what took place in that cloud or in eternity. And that was the vision recorded in the first chapter of Genesis. So now, to correlate and to show you that what I am saying here did come out of the book of Exodus and was placed over in the Genesis when the book was compiled so that Genesis would be the beginning. I'm going to have him to repeat the verse that he just read and then go into Genesis. Notice that in both instances it says the seventh day.
Exodus, the 24th chapter, and the 16th verse reads, "And the glory of the Lord arose upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud."
Now, the first chapter of Genesis and going into the second chapter of Genesis is the vision that Moses saw. And now note that I said that it took place in the realm of eternity so that you can comprehend it when he reads it out of your Bible. Now he is going to read and connect the seventh day in Exodus with the seventh day in Genesis. Read.
I'm now reading the second chapter of Genesis, beginning with the first verse. "Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day God ended his work which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all the work which he had created and made. These are the generations of the heaven and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heaven."
If you know it, he said, and I want to place strict emphasis on the words, "the day," which is the day that never ends or in the eternity where Moses saw the vision. So instead of the heavens and earth being created in the realm of time or in 6 days, it was created in eternity or in the day. For that reason, science has never been able to determine what the age of the earth is because of the fact matter is spirit materialized, and in its materialization and having took place in the realm of eternity and continues to abide in the realm of eternity. Therefore, no one can tell how old the earth is because it is a counterpart of God, and nobody can say how old God is because he is eternal. And after all that you see and know as of now, both the known and the unknown will continue to exist without any end, just constant repetition. And that's the reason why you see these repetitions on the chart, because it is the functioning of the Godhead in nature and also in this. Now, I tried to point out that how the sun works, the planet sun works with the Son of God there. Now, I want to show you on this chart in the creation so that you can see how that the purpose of God in the mind, if it was understood, could be seen both in the vegetable and animal kingdom.
when I refer to animal kingdoms, I'm talking of man. So now, notice, the Bible teaches in Matthew the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, that he was crucified on Friday. I'll name the days it doesn't say in the Bible, but crucified on Friday, rested in Joseph's tomb on Saturday. Early in the morning of the third day, he rose from the dead. But that is 3 days. So now in the creation, it is manifested like this. One, the first day, the second day, the third day. Has to read in correlation with, in Genesis, with what you have in Matthew, in the vegetable kingdom. So now we read, in the beginning, the waters covered the face of the earth. Therefore, the tomb that Jesus was buried in had to be sealed because the waters covered the face of the earth. The Spirit moving upon the face of the waters, here he bowed his head in the knots of his shoulders and gave us the soul. And then you notice that the waters continue to move upon the face of the earth. God divided the waters above, that is in ethereal space, from the physical, not the physical, but the ethereal, because always in the top part of it shows the heaven. So this is in the atomic phase, such as hydrogen and oxygen. When you put them together, they make water. But so these are the atomic elements. So down in this part, the waters were still deep on the face of the earth. And now as the angel rolled away the stone from the tomb that he was sealed up in, that Christ was sealed up in, God divided the waters on the face of the earth, forming rivers and seas, and let the dry land appear. That is the earth's resurrection. This picture is twofold, that is, its repetition within itself. So now then, the vegetable kingdom grew through and penetrated the soil on the third day, which correlates with Christ being resurrected on the third day. These veils that you see here in the vegetable kingdom represent the bud, not the fruition, because this is before the ascension. So then the veils show the bird being sealed in there. And so when the bud opens out, it flowers. You have color in that. And that's why these colors mean so much here. And then it grows on into fruition. That is to say, it passes on through this door forming the veil and this door forming the bud that I was telling you about. And when that bud falls off, it grows into fruition. That is into perfection. And now if you follow it all the way through, you will find that this is a record, even before man was created on the face of the earth. And the third day has to show the same things that happens in Matthew to the Son of God in the vegetable kingdom. And that abolishes or eliminates any reason of doubt that the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ on the third day is nothing but the truth to itself. Now then, you go on down to the next day, the fourth day, the fifth day, the sixth day. And going on down to the sixth day, it's 3 days from the third day, one, two, three. And so then he's got to take that man from the earth, which is a figure of this great anthropomorphic being. The woman must be in the man here, because Christ was as a lamb slain before the foundation of the earth. The beginning of this migration, the lamb was slain there. It was dark down in Egypt, and so it's got to be dark here. So if the lamb was slain before they left there in the darkness, so the lamb before the foundation of the earth must be saved here. Therefore, he was a land same as from the foundation of the earth. Now, since Adam was, the rib was taken from his side, then he must, the woman, or in the region of the abdominal region, then the birth of the universe took place in the abdominal region of the great, inexcusable theory of the universe. That is why we call this the archetype pattern of the universe. Now, man being taken from the dust of the earth, he must reflect this crucifixion in the side at the beginning. He must reflect the fear, this slaying of the Paschal Lamb. And so now Adam, he must fall asleep here before any sin is committed, and the woman Eve must be taken from his side there. And since you see how the rib was taken from his side, then if you look over into Matthew, you can see the logical reason why the Christ had to be punctured in his side when he was on the cross. And you can see that the church is what? Shown by many of the saints that slept in the dust of the earth, rose and went on into Jerusalem, as it is reflected on the chart over there. All of them put together that are saved constitute his bride or his wife.